I would really define deeper learning as the ability to apply critical thinking skills. I want to take the emphasis away from searching for the right answer and really, place that emphasis on being able to analyze available evidence and being able to construct their own conclusions. What I really like about this unit, they open with an anchoring phenomenon where students are investigating a mysterious reddish-brown substance coming out of the pipes of this fictitious, town that we're investigating. And so they've since identified that substance as rust. And so now we're really zooming into that atomic level to investigate how that rust formed. And so that's really what's helping us build our understanding of the law of conservation of matter. We're gonna go ahead and get started with today's class assignment. We're gonna use the next 6 minutes completing those different questions on pages 1 and 2. And already I see Nathan is diving in. I see Valencia is using that atomic analysis. Journey's adding different annotations right to that classwork assignment. JB's adding that scientific vocabulary. Journey's moving with that urgency. She's moving on to that second page. Really high mastery on that first question. Layla's annotating that question carefully, adding that scientific vocabulary, sixth grade. Who's got that science notebook open, using those resources? All right, sixth grade, look at that is all right. We're gonna go ahead and pause. We have these two different models here, right? One of them is showing a chemical reaction. We're gonna start with a quick class poll. Silent hand raised if you selected option A. Silent hand raised if you selected option B. Silent hand raised if you selected option C. That's a strong hand, Nathan. Silent hand raised if you selected option D. Option B is absolutely the correct answer here, sixth grade. Model 2 is that accurate chemical reaction, but why? Raising a silent hand, how did you know? Sixth grade, listen carefully to the question. What's wrong with Model 1? Why isn't Model 1 showing a chemical reaction?
What do you think about it?
Model 1 isn't a chemical reaction.
But all of the atoms were conserved.
Yes. And it didn't rearrange.
What didn't rearrange? We gotta be specific. Those atoms didn't rearrange. Excellent.
Yadier, nice and loud. What's going on here? Why is Model 1 incorrect?
Model 1 is not a chemical reaction because none of the atoms rearranged.
Excellent. He's using that scientific vocabulary. I'm seeing some connections from the group. Take these next few moments, finish adding those notes right to those classwork assignments, just like I see from Valencia. Flipping to that second page in the assignment, we are cooking with gas, sixth grade. Right now, I wanna hear from Remy. You agreed with Cameron. You said those properties are going to be different. Why? Remy, nice and loud. Why'd you say those properties will be different?
Because in sample one, they had two oxygen molecules.
Why don't we use the colors? You said two, what color?
Two white atoms and one red atom.
And what about sample two, Remy?
They also have two white atoms and one red atom.
Remy definitely did that strong atomic analysis. Madden, I noticed that you disagreed with Cameron. Why did you disagree with Cameron, Madden?
It's because the atoms and molecules are the exact same. The only thing different is the amount of repeating atoms that sample two has.
Well, Madden is bringing up this idea of water, right? And so tracking up front, just like Ken Lee, just like Journey, right? We have two different water bottles, each filled with the same substance. Do we see that there, sixth grade?
Okay.
Which sample, now look carefully, which sample do you think, sample one or sample two, do you think this water bottle represents? Which sample, right, the one in my right hand, sample one or sample two, do you think this water bottle represents and why?
That water bottle represents sample two because it has more molecules, therefore more atoms in it, so it's gonna have more water. And the second water bottle in your hand is going to represent sample one because it has less molecules and atoms. So it's going to have less H2O.
Use these next few moments to finish adding those notes right to those models. All right. And so we're going to take a quick look at a video that's going to help introduce this next activity. What is the connection between the law of conservation and chemical reactions?
Let's imagine some other processes that can demonstrate this law. Think of a copper pipe. If we leave this pipe to the outdoor elements, where it will come into contact with water from the rain and oxygen from the atmosphere, we know that this pipe will rust.
Wait a second, rusty pipes. What does that remind us of, sixth grade? Raising those silent hands. Jahari, what does that remind us of?
How the rust formed in the Westfield
wells. Excellent, reminding us of that anchoring phenomenon, right? And we also investigated how that rust did form. Raising a silent hand, how did that rust get into the pipes of Westfield? How? Yadier, how?
By how the water was transferring through pipes into people's homes.
Absolutely. And we saw some different substances reacting as well, right? Does anybody remember what those different substances were? I see those gears are turning for Avery. Avery, nice and loud.
They used fertilizer, and that was found in the well. And it was also, the water came out as a reddish brown substance.
And when the oxygen molecules react with the copper pipe, they are adding their mass to the pipe.
Sixth grade, can atoms be created? Can atoms be destroyed?
No.
Do atoms change into different types of atoms?
No.
Could we use that information, the law of conservation, to maybe calculate some of those different masses of some of those different substances? Well, that's what we're gonna investigate in this next activity.
In the equation below, 20 grams of hydrogen H2 reacted with 25 grams of oxygen, what is the total mass of the product water?
How can we use the law of conservation to solve this problem?
We could add the grams.
The grams of what, Yadier?
The atoms.
Well, let's take a look. And so we're just going to use Yadier's advice. Yeah, Layla, what is the total mass of the reactants we started with?
I got 45.
45 what? Staples?
45 grams.
Excellent. And Layla made sure to add that unit right to her response. How can we use that law of conservation to calculate the total of the products? What are you thinking, sixth grade?
I'm thinking that on the product side, it's gonna have 45 grams because we have to have the same number of grams that we did on the reactor side.
Valencia is saying, well, let's get, if we are starting with 45 total grams of reactants, per that law of conservation of matter, she knows we must also be ending with 45 grams of products. Does that make sense, sixth grade?
Yeah.
Which one speak louder, sixth grade, your actions or your words?
Actions.
Great, so if you understand it, you're gonna go ahead and prove it. You're gonna move on to questions two, three, and four. Of course, you have to show your work, sixth grade. Listen, you cracked the code, but you didn't show none of that work. I'm gonna push you to go back and add that work in there.
For that one, I think it's gonna be 85.
Yes.
I'm glad it's been turning like this.
What are y'all stuck on?
Number three.
Alright, so write the reactant on the product thing that we did right there on the board. It will help. Yeah, right the reactant product thing that they did on the board. It will help.
What I did was subtracting 107 by. So I just subtracted 107.
You add this, okay.
And
then subtract it 20.
Right. Yeah. And then
you get 100.
Subtract.
We're subtracting, bottom of the full.
Like you said, the atoms can't change.
So yeah, that's what I'm saying. So you add the first two numbers, and then you subtract the third number.
All right, sixth grade, that's all right. We're going to come back together and take a look. What is the total mass of the reactants here? Amira, what do you think? You got to turn it up nice and loud.
107.
107 what, Amira?
Grams.
Of? You know what? We could just stop there for now, actually. 107 grams, right? What else? What else are we missing?
And now you add them together to get 128.
So we have calculated the total mass of the reactants. Are we done yet, sixth grade?
No.
Now what, Remy? Nice and loud. And Remy's going right back to that question to pull direct evidence.
Minus 28 of hydrogen gas.
Turn and talk with your peers. Why? Turn and talk.
Yeah, and what is this? This is what?
28 grams of what?
Those voices are off, and you are tracking Layla and zero and zero. Layla, why would we subtract 28 grams here? Nice and loud. Nice and loud.
We would subtract 28 grams because we're only trying to figure out the mass of the sodium chloride. So we subtracted the hydrogen gas, so then we could get how much of the the sodium chloride there is.
That question number three, at the board. Okay, Adam's gonna model his calculations up at the board, and so while he's modeling his work, we should be checking it against our work at our desks.
Concept.
All right, sixth grade. Those volumes are off. Adam, walk us through what you're doing up there. Help us out. Right now, we should be tracking up front at that level zero. Adam, make it happen.
I added the sulfuric acid to the sodium hydroxide.
Perfect.
Which equaled 178 grams. Then I took away the 18 grams of water since we don't need it. And then I got 160 grams of sodium sulfate.
Adam, you gotta check to see if the group has any questions for you, man.
It doesn't show the water. Where's the water?
H2O.
Yeah, but on the bottom.
It's like H2O. It says H2O.
Okay.
H2O.
What label?
So why don't you add it and then subtract it?
We only needed these two. The sulfuric acid and the sodium hydroxide, whatever.
Excellent. Listen, Adam, thank you so much for helping us wrap that up. That total mass produced, just like Adam said, 160 grams of that sodium sulfate, right? Science notebook's closed. Tearing out that page 7 and diving right in. Amira's advocating for the color version of that image. I have it up on the board. This one, right? All right, so look. All right, what did Leanna do with adult supervision? What did she do?
She did a combustion reaction.
Okay, sure. So let's say that this was the retake, right? And so just like you're noticing, right?
Yeah.
That combustion reaction happened, right? And the combustion reaction means what? It means that it what, Madden?
It's on fire.
It was on fire. So what happened to all the mass from that? How though? Where is it? Conserved where?
The atoms models most we have either escaped during the fire or has
escaped where though? Where'd they go?
Air.
As escaped as air?
No, as carbon dioxide.
Oh, as carbon dioxide.
Yeah.
That, I don't know, right? We were actually gonna investigate. I was hoping that we'd have some time to look at. There's a link right here. Right? And so maybe that was going to help us out. You use your key concept and you already generated some different ideas.
One of the lessons I try to bring home for my students is the simplicity behind science. I was working with one of the students and I had a little kind of jar. That student had made it to one of the questions we didn't get to whole group. It was comparing one substance before being burned and afterwards. If atoms cannot be destroyed, if they cannot be created, well then what happened to the rest of this substance, right? Where is it? So I thought it was really cool that, you know, I had a student that had made it to that question and we did get the opportunity to discuss it a little bit, and especially in that one-to-one check-in kind of format, to have that hands-on manipulative, even working with just the one student, I think it really was able to hammer home that law of conservation.
You showed some of your work, but I don't see you split up. You didn't see the atomic analysis. I don't see you calculating the different sides, right? You know what's funny, Jahari? You're doing it now that I told you, right? But if you did this when you had attempted the question, I bet you would have had a different answer. Prove me right now, Jahari. Wow, would you look at that? So why did your answer change?
Because I realized if I subtract 95 by 10, I would get 85.
Yeah, but you didn't subtract those 10 grams when you weren't showing your work. So it almost looks like showing your work is helping you be more successful. Would you agree, Jahari?
Yeah, I'm going to pull my grades right now.
A short-term outcome of students engaging in that deeper learning in the classroom really, I do think, is a boost in that confidence. For them to be able to go from a place of, I don't understand what's happening in this question, I think by the end of it, right, when we've stamped that concept and they've able to see, like, hey, I got the question wrong 2 times at first, right? I was able to apply some of those different strategies and work together with my team members and arrive at that answer. And so by the end, I think that there is that rush, you know, of confidence that comes for students. And that's like in the short term. In the longer term, I think that it applies to, you know, essentially, you know, all areas of their life, building those critical thinking skills.